Broadcasting live from the Civic Media Studios in Green Bay, this is Nite Lite with Pete Schwaba, your inside source on everything entertainment from Wisconsin to Hollywood. And now, a guy who once tore his ACL playing chess, Pete Schwaba.
Welcome back. Well, that was insightful. I don't know if you guys are independent film fans or film fans in general, but I hope those incentives pass. I think it's great. I think it would be great for our state, for tourism, filmmaking, all kinds of stuff. The states with the incentives do very well. And some of the numbers I've seen are crazy. I mean, the screen, like in Georgia, they did a study for every dollar invested in film and television incentives in the state, they get like $6.30 back. That's incredible. And in Montana, they did a recent study that found that the production of Paramount Network's Yellowstone generated 2.1 million new visitors, which led to $730 million in the local economic activity, added over 10,000 jobs and about $45 million in state tax revenue, all a result from their film incentives program. So if Jeffrey and his crew in Milwaukee can get this thing going, I meant to ask him where they think they would headquarter the film office. I always assume it would be in Madison, but I think most of these activists are in Milwaukee. So maybe they would keep it there. Either way, there is so much to be had and so many benefits from tax incentives when it comes to shooting film and TV. Not to mention the jobs it brings with just people in the film industry, but like the extracurriculars on the peripheral side of things like Conrad's hometown, the bar, and the people that catered that movie that they shot. So it the benefits are incredible. So did you we're waiting on Ben Reiser will be joining us soon to talk about the Wisconsin Film Festival. He is I know those guys are running around like crazy down there, and they don't sleep much as this week. Did you tell him 8:30?
Yeah.
Oh. Okay. Tell him we're ready whenever, if you would. I'll tell him. Say something, Conrad, while I text him.
Pete's texting him. This is what makes radio great right here. Just you texting someone, and then the producer having to say what he's doing.
So I sent this to you, this list of cities.
Yeah.
Was it the top 145? Where is that? I just had that. It's like the top, yeah, the healthiest, right? Mm-hmm. It was the healthiest 100.
Yep. And it's the healthiest and unhealthiest cities.
I didn't see the unhealthiest.
I believe I just printed the healthiest, though.
Okay. That's all we want. Madison was 17th as the most healthy. San Francisco was number one. Chicago, 34. Minneapolis was in the 20s, I think. But Madison was 17.
Milwaukee's 81.
81, yeah.
And I'm trying to find Green Bay, but I'm not seeing it.
Green Bay was not on the list.
Wow.
So Green Bay was also voted the number one place to live.
Yeah.
For a city under 200,000 people or something like that. But that shows you how great Green Bay is, because apparently the people here are not very healthy, but it's still the number one place.
It's all the drinking.
Yeah, right. Here we got some clarifications on our question tonight. You can still get in on the action. If you could create a disgusting product, what would it be? I.e. hot dog flavored seltzer water, sour cream and onion on a stick. What was it? Popsicles?
It was so,
horrible.
The Pringles sour cream and onion, but in a soda.
In a soda.
In a probiotic soda.
Finally, the great taste of Worcestershire sauce in a soft drink. Bridget clarified, cheeseburger in a tube. It looks like a tube of toothpaste. And you could buy it on Amazon. It's just foul. From the 603, our new texter John from Madison says, Rodney Dangerfield, back to school in Madison. Yeah, that is one of the iconic film shot here in Wisconsin for sure. And that's one of those films when it comes on, I'll always give it a watch for at least like 20 minutes because I remember a line or two I want to see. From the 920, Steve says, kickoff at this year's Wisconsin State Fair, chocolate-covered pickles. Is that fake? I don't know. It's Wisconsin. We can pass anything. Yeah.
Probably is there.
Probably is real. Let's grab a handful, Steve. Hey, we got a very fun guest here. He's been on the show several times before. He is in the throes of making film viewers happy in Wisconsin at the Wisconsin Film Festival. And they're running around like crazy because tomorrow is opening night, April 4th at the Barrymore. Opening night, always a blast. The film festival runs through April 11th, and we are lucky enough to have Ben Reiser to give us even more information here with us tonight on Nite Lite. Hey, Ben.
Hey, Pete.
How are you?
I'm all right. I'm already missing you. Normally, you'd be part of the opening night festivities, but now with this fancy new every night of the week radio program you got going on, you know, you're too busy. You've become too big time for us, Pete.
I would have had to burn a vacation day. That wouldn't have sat well, but after I said I couldn't do it, I was like, you know, I probably should have taken, I don't know, whatever. I didn't know what to do. Maybe next year we could work something out, because that is a fun night. I love doing it.
You think you're still going to be on with this thing next year?
Well, we'll see how this interview goes. I know one guest who might not be invited back.
For fun. I'm sorry. I just came from installing a screen at the oldest building on campus. So,
What's the oldest building on campus?
A music hall. I might have just made that up. Nice. I don't know. It seems like it's the oldest building. It looks like a church. It's got a clock tower on it. It's got to be the oldest building, right?
Oh, yeah, totally. Hey, let's start there. Tell us about the venues. You guys have some new venues. The Sundance Cinemas are no longer there. For those of you listening, the Wisconsin Film Festival typically uses, you guys have 6 or 7 venues every year?
Yeah.
Does that sound about right?
That's right.
And they're all
on
really
and
good.
Off of the UW campus, because we are a university-sponsored event. So we do some stuff on the UW Madison campus, and then we reach out into the community. As long as there are movie theaters off campus, we'll try to take advantage of them. And if there aren't movie theaters, we'll take any old space and we'll turn it into a movie theater for 8 days. What the heck?
Yeah, why not? You guys are back at the Barrymore this year. I think it was about 4 years ago you were there for opening night. That was really fun, a really cool venue. Love the neighborhood it's in. Why is the Barrymore so special?
Yeah, I remember that opening night. We had Mark Borchardt, the star of American Movie, with us on stage. That was
we did a Q&A there with, I got to do a Q&A with Butch and Steve from the Smart Studio Story, Butch Vig, and Wendy Schneider
That's
was
right.
there. That was really That's fun right. and a fun Q&A and to do.
Michael Feldman, who used to also have a radio show of his own, was there that night too.
That's right.
Yeah, the Barrymore is just great. I mean, it's got a ton of vibes to it. I mean, that's a theater that has been everything from a movie theater to an adult movie theater.
Oh, is that right?
And to a concert venue for the last, I don't know, 20 years or so. It's a wonderful place. It's got a lobby full of all kinds of bizarre sort of Wisconsin tchotchkes, as they say here in Madison. It's got a ceiling that's got like little lights that look like stars.
Yeah. I love those old time. That's so cool. I was talking about the Barrymore earlier on the show, Ben. What is the capacity? Is it like 800 or 1,000?
You know, it used to be 800, but they redid the seats, and they have slightly larger, more comfortable seats than they used to. So I think we're down to 750 officially. But I think that we can still add a couple of rows of temporary seats towards the front of the orchestra and maybe turn it back into 800. Because actually opening night, which is, as you say, tomorrow night, is sold out of advance tickets.
That was my next question. Wow. Okay. That's cool. So do you have films still at Shannon Hall this year? That's such a big venue.
No, as successful and popular as a festival is, such as the Wisconsin Film Festival, I don't think we have the need for more than one of these old movie palaces. So it's either sort of Shannon Hall or the Orpheum Theater or the Capitol Theater, which is part of the Overture Center, or the Barrymore. You know, we sort of have rotated through those venues from year to year, depending on which one of those venues has availability for us, because it's not so easy even a year in advance to book these places, because, you know, they've got what we like to say in Wisconsin, bigger fish to fry. You know, they've got national touring acts coming through where they can make a lot more money than they can with us, with our, you know, some people think exorbitant $12 ticket price for these movies.
Oh, come on.
you know, but they could have, you know, a Steely Dan cover band and charge $50 a ticket.
Steely Dan.
So Steely Dan, exactly. Steely Dan.
My wife does not like crowds. She got invited to what she thought was a Steely Dan concert. She's like, mm-hmm. I mean, $20, I have to go, right? I'm like, yeah. Right. So she goes with her sister. They go to Milwaukee. They get a hotel room. And she texts me. She goes, it's Steely Dan. I'm like, yeah, that makes sense. But she said it was still a great show.
Well, because there was probably no crowd there. It was probably wonderful, right?
All I know is she was asked to leave the dance floor, and with good reason. So is the Orpheum one of the venues this year?
No.
Okay.
No. Again, we've got the one big house, and that's the Barrymore. The second largest venue that we have this year is the Marquee at Union South, which you've hosted many a panel discussion at. That's 330 seats. Everything else is a distant third, fourth, fifth, and sixth. I think after that 330 seat venue, our next largest venue might be the largest screen at our new venue this year, which is Flicks Brewhouse, which is a new multiplex.
Oh, yeah.
I say new. It's 4 or 5 years old at this point. New for us over at the East Town Mall. So this is the furthest east we've been, I think, ever for the Wisconsin Film Festival. And, you know, we're halfway to Milwaukee by the time we get to the East Town Mall. But they've got a theater that we're using. It's, I think, 225 seats. So that's the third largest. So 750, 330, 225, and everything else is in the hundreds.
That I could have sworn Union South was more than 330 seats. It just has a bigger feel to it.
It does. It's a big, wide open room with a high ceiling. It does feel like at least 500 seats.
Yeah. So tell people about, let's get a quick plug in for you before we do some business here real quick. Tell people about your podcast, Ben.
Oh, well, I've got many.
Oh, you do?
I do. Well, no, I do a weekly podcast, with the lead singer, songwriter, guitarist. It's only a two-man band. So basically the guy does just about everything except drum. This guy, Scott Lucas, for this band Local H. Maybe you've heard of them. They had a big hit in the 90s with this Bound for the Floor song that people think is called Copacetic because the chorus is just don't get it, keep it copacetic, and you learn to accept it. You know that? Is that before your time or after your time?
I'm in my late 20s. I don't know.
Well, I know you're a Springsteen fan like I am, but did you ever get into the sort of post-grunge alt-rock?
I did a little bit. You know what? Let's pick it up there. We got to do a quick thing here. And then I want to ask you about the film American Smell Good. More coming up with Ben Reiser next on Nite Lite with Pete Schwaba on the Civic Media Radio Network. Welcome back. Thanks for hanging with me on a Wednesday night, broadcasting live over the beautiful state of Wisconsin from City Deck Landing in Green Bay. Great to have you with me. We're talking with Ben Reiser from the Wisconsin Film Festival. Ben, you were in the middle of a story, and I rudely cut you off because we have these crazy hard breaks. So I had to jump in, but please continue.
I don't even know what I was talking about. I think I was talking about my podcast.
Yeah,
my
your Lifers podcast.
Podcast. Every week with the guys from Local H. We talk to other rock semi-legends of the 90s that Scott grew up in the music business with, and he calls them lifers, people who are still in the music business, whether they're making any money at it or not, people who just can't get that out of their blood, you know?
Yeah, that's so cool. We have a show on Saturday night, a live show right there on State Street called Max Inc. every Saturday night. We should talk about that. He would probably be a great guest for them.
I didn't know anything about this.
Yeah,
you're in Madison every Saturday night.
Not me, but Terry Barr and a guy named Rocker host it, and it's live music for it's phenomenal. So, yeah, we could talk about that. I'm sure they would love to.
Tell me about Terry Barr, compare and contrast with Terry Agar.
I don't know Terry Agar. Who is Terry Agar?
Not Terry Agar. Sorry, Terry Garr.
Terry Garr. Well,
that was me saying Terry and me ruining my own joke. Terry Garr.
Yeah, whenever you have to say a punchline twice, it's kind of, and people just go, oh, but it would have been hilarious on the first one. That's tough.
That's why I'm doing a music podcast and a film podcast, but not a comedy podcast.
So All right. So tell us during the...
you know who we had on the show?
No,
Speaking of the world of comedy, this guy, Kyle Kinane. Do you know him?
I've heard that name.
Chicago-based comedian. Yeah. He's supposed to be very hip with the kids.
He was on your music podcast?
Yeah, because he had listened to the podcast once, and we heard him talk about it, and we got excited and brought him on.
Oh, that's cool. Fun. That's a great thing about podcasts. You do whatever you want, you know what I mean? Like, in terms of guests or...
Yeah, as opposed to this thing.
They tell me to have you on. Yeah, exactly. So, Amir Kakaroz, am I saying that right?
No, I don't think so, but I don't know that I can do it any better. Amir Kakaroz. Kakaroz. I think there's a Z at the end, right?
Yeah, but I thought either way.
It's a little bit like cockroach, but you don't want to say that.
You don't
right?
want to say
but
that. Amir. And he's a good guy. I've interviewed him a couple times on PBS, and he made a great film several years ago called River West Film and Video, I think was the title of it, right?
Yeah.
Loved it.
He's made a lot of great films, and he's very funny. Very good interview.
He is, and he's a really good guy. I saw a trailer for
tonight.
Huh?
He should be on tonight.
Why? Well, listen, I can squeeze him in on Friday. I was telling you guys, if you have someone you need more butts in the seats, let's talk about that, because I do have one slot still open on Friday. But his film is called Americans Smell Good, and the trailer is hilarious. What can you tell me about that film?
Well, the trailer is like a song, and it is strange because it's basically a documentary, and it sort of tells the stories about three different people that he's met in his time living in Milwaukee. He's been here, I don't know, at least 10 years or so.
Yeah.
Having emigrated from Turkey. He's an interesting guy and manages to meet interesting people and then make interesting films about those people. But for some reason, about 5 minutes into the movie, it sort of launches into this music video about the fact that people from Turkey and other sort of Eastern European countries think that the thing about Americans is that they smell good. That's one of the defining characteristics, you know, that Americans are very into sort of personal hygiene and using deodorant and things like that. So he's got this music video. It's a fun documentary in that it goes off in all kinds of weird directions like that. 1 minute it's a music video, then it's a very serious sort of portrait of a guy who's very involved with Black Lives Matter. Then there's a section about this experimental filmmaker, Cecilia Condit. So it kind of bounces all over the place, but with Amir sort of as the central sort of anchor of the film. You know, it's his experiences with all these people that he's met in Milwaukee.
That's really interesting. And that's why I just like River West Film and Video was like that. I'm like, what am I watching here? And the more I got into it, I just loved it. It was like kind of hypnotic almost, you know.
It's great. I remember that's a scene from that movie where one of the stranger guys who works at River West Film and Video is cooking like a chicken dinner. Yeah. Do you remember this? Like
for the whole group.
I mean, yeah. But it's like he fished this chicken out of a garbage can or something. But there's a few of Amir's films that sort of have at least one scene where somebody's cooking or baking something. And no matter how bizarre it is, I still end up wanting to sort of try whatever is being made. He somehow has a way of making these things look appetizing that you would not normally think.
I agree with
something
you.
Something you want to put in your mouth.
The chicken did look good. My guest is Ben Reiser from the Wisconsin Film Festival, which opens tomorrow night and runs through April 11th. It's a great festival. If you haven't been there, there's over 150 films. It's just a phenomenal time. So see as many films as you can and check it out. There's another film. I was contacted by a filmmaker called Emily Alprin, who is from Milwaukee, she reached out last night about coming on the show, and her film is called Trying. Do you know anything about that one?
Yeah, it's a short film from our Wisconsin Zone section about a woman who's trying to get pregnant. And it's sweet, it's funny, it's a little bit sad. I mean, it's a narrative, but I feel like it's definitely autobiographical in nature, even though it's a quote unquote fiction film.
Yeah.
A woman, you know, sort of as lots of women these days, sort of realize at the end of their 30s that they're like, hey, if I don't get pregnant now, I might not be able to. And so it's sort of that tells that little story in about a 10-minute chunk. And it's a very good film.
It's very unfair too, because guys can pull a Tony Randall if they want and wait 50 more years.
Don't get me started on Tony Randall. I don't even know where to begin or end with that guy.
You do not have a Tony Randall story, do you?
No, I don't. But I do. There was this thing. I don't know if you ever saw this. There was this crazy Sid and Marty Krofft offshoot of the Brady Bunch where they got all the cast from the Brady Bunch to do these Brady Bunch variety hours. where they would do like song and dance numbers and have like H&R Puff and Stuff style, like weird creatures. And there's an episode where Tony Randall is the guest star on this variety show. And he does this insane Edna St. Vincent Millay. Is that the name of a poet? He does this crazy poem from the 1800s and he's dressed up like a leprechaun. And there are these awful looking people in bear costumes sort of dancing around him. It's the three craziest minutes I've ever seen on TV. I'm going to find it on YouTube and send it to you. That's
please. It reminded me a little when you were talking about that, about the scene in The Big Lebowski where they go to see the, as Lebowski calls it, the what mm-hmm. have you, or no, John Goodman says, well, we'll go there, embrace the kid after the what have you. And his landlord's doing that interpretive dance.
Yeah.
Oh, it's exactly. So great. What's the Janet Planet film, Ben?
Well, Janet Planet, I haven't seen, but it's one of, you know, here's the thing. Here's a crazy thing going on in the movie business these days. That studio, A24,
yeah,
they put their name, anything they put their name on, half of the population that goes to see movies under the age of 30, they're there. They're,
it's boom. Crazy.
We actually, we you know, these days we try to get the UW-Madison students more involved in the festival because it's interesting. We're a hugely popular festival off campus and in the greater Madison community, right. But on campus, it's hard to get the attention of these students. But one thing we can do is offer them free tickets, which we are doing this year.
Oh, nice.
And another thing we can do is tempt them with free sneak previews of A24 films.
Oh, so nice.
Earlier this week, we showed them a different A24 film at the Marquee at Union South, something called I Saw the TV Glow. And we packed the house, and then we showed them coming attractions for festival movies and gave them free tickets afterwards in the hopes that they'll come hang out with us for the rest of the week. But Janet Planet is another A24 film. And so,
hey, Ben, hold that thought for 1 second. Okay, we'll be right back with more. I'm trying to do this gently. It's so hard. We'll have more, a few minutes more with Ben Reiser from the Wisconsin Film Festival and Nite Lite coming up next.
Did you miss what's hot from Wisconsin to Hollywood? Listen to Nite Lite with Pete Schwaba podcast on civicmedia.us. You can always listen through Spotify, Apple Podcast, or the Civic Media app. Take Nite Lite with Pete Schwaba anywhere you go. Once again, here is your host, Pete Schwaba.
Welcome back. My guest is Ben Reiser from the Wisconsin Film Festival. We were in the middle of talking about Janet Planet. And so let's pick up there, Ben. Is this
where were you? I think we moved past Janet Planet.
No, you told a story about you. I know it seems like a long time ago, but you you told a story.
Yeah, well, we get the kids in line with our A24.
That's it. A24.
We sprinkle a little A24 before and during and after the festival that keeps them in line. I mean, it's like hypnotic. They see that A24 logo and they're like, "Take me to the movie."
Isn't that crazy? When I was a kid, probably 25 years ago, I remember something from the studio that brought you such and such. And I'm like, nobody cares who made this film. No one. But now I've been proven wrong because you're right. The kids love A20 and they do cool stuff.
It's kind of like the Criterion Channel and Criterion home video releases for the younger generation. You know, it's a weird cult, but hey, if it helps us, God bless.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, and they do put out a lot of good movies, but I mean, I'm not running to see something just because A24 put it out. Hey, that's just me. I love A24. Don't get me wrong. I'm going to get in trouble here. I gotta care for what I say. So we had Terry Barr, and then we had Terry Garr.
Right.
And then on the news just now, I heard my friend Terry Bell. You got a lot of Terrys going on around
here. It's hard to keep. Well, Terry, wait, what's her name? Terry Garr? That's the actress.
She doesn't really have anything to do with your show. I'm sorry.
I've been trying to get her. I want her to be my foil, but she won't return my calls. So Wendy Schneider has a new film. We just talked about her last film, The Smart Studio Story, Angels of Dirt. Yeah. Wendy was on the show last week. She's great. She's such a fun guest. Have you seen that film? I'm hoping to get to see it. It looks really good.
I have seen that film. It's funny. Wendy spent the last 2 years trying to get me to see this film. I think, I swear, in 2022, she wrote me. She said, "I'm working on this film. I want you to come." She's very careful about how she shares, you know, the film while it's in progress. She won't send people a link or anything like that. I had to go to her home studio, sit there with headphones and watching on a computer monitor all by myself.
Oh, wow.
Then we had lunch afterwards and we talked about the movie. But she spent like a year and a half trying to get me to do it. And we just couldn't sync up. But I finally saw it about 6 months ago. And I thought it was great. And I said, well, hey, let's show this at the festival this year. So that kind of, I think, inspired her to get it done in time to show it. You know, we had that historic, iconic Smart Studio Story screening at the Barrymore in 2017.
Yeah.
On a Sunday night, you're right, with Butch Vig in attendance and you on stage. And I thought, let's do that again for Angels of Dirt. I mean, it doesn't have the sort of universal, and when I say universal, I mean Madison, appeal of a Smart Studio Story. Because, you know, you hear Smart Studios around here and people are like, oh my God, sign me up. It's like the A24 of Madison. but God bless Wendy. She is a force to be reckoned with. You know, she's an incredible filmmaker. She's really an incredible musician, but she's an incredible promoter. I mean, I said to her, listen, we can put this in any one of the theaters that you want. We've got these 200 seat houses, 300 seat houses. I said, I can give you the same Barrymore slot that we had for Smart Studios, but I don't want to put that kind of pressure on you. She said, oh no, no, let's do it. I'm going to sell it out. And darned if she isn't on her way to selling out the Barrymore again for this, you know, film. That's,
oh, really?
A much more personal, a much less sort of universal appeal movie. It's a, you know, it's a niche documentary about this, Charlotte Canes, who was, an incredible, you know, motor, I guess they call them motorbikes, motocross racer,
right.
Who tragically died in a race at age 20, but Wendy had been following her around for a couple of years, interviewing her and getting footage of her. And she's been sitting on that footage for, you know, a decade now, not quite sure what to do with it, and like working on it a little bit at a time, while other things pulled her away. And amazingly, she put it together, and it's a beautiful piece of work. And it's going to be another great, great, like historic, iconic screening at the Wisconsin Film Festival this Sunday.
That's really cool. So it is not sold out yet.
No, you can still get some tickets, but I am stunned at the amount of tickets we've sold for this thing. So
we have to, Conrad, take a memo.
Sounds good.
We have to get, remember Wendy said we could do a giveaway. I got to reach out to her because that was last Friday. So we better get on that if we want to give some tickets. Well,
you talk to me about the giveaway. I'm the one with the tickets. I'll send you.
So, yeah, we cut out the middleman. Cut out the filmmaker.
Yeah, Wendy's just going to text me and say, hey, I need 10 more tickets for Pete Schwaba. Okay, great.
Hey, we're in. We would love to do that if you have the tickets to spare, Ben. But it sounds like things are, just let us know.
You can always have some tickets.
So in terms of the Q&As to me, and I'm not saying anything you don't know, are about film festivals. That's the best thing. You get to go there. You get to see a great film. You get to, you know, experience the Q&A, meet the filmmaker. You just don't get that when you go see regular movies. So what are there guests you have this year that people have to go see their film and then stick around for the Q&A, like a Hundreds of Beavers type performance at the Q&A that you had a couple of years ago?
Well, as I think we talked about last time I was here, we've got Alexander Payne coming to this year's festival. We're going to show a 20th anniversary screening of Sideways, and then Alexander Payne's going to be there to answer any questions you might have about Sideways and tell fun stories about how much fun it is to direct Paul Giamatti, you know, once every 20 years. it's going to be great. And of course, we've got Wendy Schneider. She's, as you say, a great interview. It's going to be a really emotional experience for her bringing this film to Madison. And we've got a ton of great filmmakers. It's true. It's a really exciting thing to be in a room with a filmmaker who's showing films to audiences, you know, really for the first time in most cases, or certainly early on in their runs. You know, a lot of times people send their films through the festival circuit and then hope at some point they get picked up by a distributor and get shown in, you know, regular movie theaters to regular paying audiences. But this festival experience for both the filmmakers and the audience is they're all experiencing something new, and to be able to get that sort of feedback from the audience, not only when they're watching the film, sitting as a filmmaker, sitting in, you've done this, Pete, right?
Yeah,
you're sitting
sure.
in a theater with people who are seeing this thing that you've been working on for years, and you're hearing them laugh or hearing them cry or hearing them yawn. But you're really getting, you know, you're getting that feedback, and then to be able to have meaningful conversations with them afterwards. It's just incredible for the filmmakers and the audiences. So
it's the best thing easily about any film festival, but you guys do a phenomenal job of it too. My film showed at the Orpheum there was a ton of people there. And I, the sound was just so crazy at the Orpheum back in like 2007. Yeah. I was having a conniption in the back of the theater, but nobody cared. They stuck around for the Q&A and it was just an absolute blast. Okay. So I've been reading about big screen little folks for years, Ben. I've never made it to one of their showings or hosted a Q&A there, I don't think. What is that? And for people with kids maybe that might be listening, what can they expect there?
Well, this is actually the 10th year that we're doing this Big Screens Little Folks section of the festival. And, you know, at some point, this woman, Karen Kolb, who used to work for the festival, came up with this idea. Hey, you know, it's a big festival. We're trying to offer something for everyone. Why aren't we doing more with family films, films for children? And so we said, you're right. And more importantly, let's find films that you're not going to see on the Disney Channel. You're not going to see on Saturday morning. You know, there used to be Saturday morning TV for kids. Like when I was a kid, now I don't know what goes on Saturday mornings, but you know, it's something that isn't going to be on Nickelodeon. And so finding short films and feature length films from around the world, and then figuring out what age groups those films are going to appeal to, because we love to bring in kids in kindergarten through second grade, but you know, there's a language barrier. So we have to look and find films that communicate visually and aren't reliant on, you know, verbal stuff. And so we have a whole hour plus shorts program called Shorter and Sweeter, where we have shorts, children's shorts from around the world, fantastic animated stuff and some live action stuff, but almost all of them without dialogue, so that, you know, anybody can sit there and watch these things. And then we have another shorts program called Short and Sweet for kids, maybe third grade through fifth grade, where there is some dialogue and there are some subtitles. But at that point, kids can do some reading, you know, and these films are geared for children. And those are incredible. And then we also find a handful of features from around the world that are, you know, kids movies, but kids movies from Germany or the Netherlands or Africa. You know, we take it really seriously and we're really proud of the films that we're able to find from around the world. And it's been a really popular program and it's been a wonderful addition to the festival. And yeah, we got to get you out to one of those. Well, I'm going to drag you over to this movie Dancing Queen that we're showing on Sunday.
I saw that. And the guide. Yeah, that looks fantastic. I would love it.
It's very funny. You'll like it.
So you guys always have great restored classics too. I saw a few years ago, I saw Ladies and Gentlemen, The Fabulous Stains with Diane Lane and a very young Ray Winstone. That was pretty cool. What do you have this year? Anything big like that? Or,
well, we've got something crazy this year. We're showing the Vincent Price masterpiece, The Tingler.
Oh yeah.
And we're showing it in Percepto. Which is the an original process that William Castle came up with in the 50s or the 60s. I can't remember which one. I can't talk too much about it, but you'll have an electrifying experience in your seat.
Oh, Mike King did tell me a little bit about that. I won't say anything either. That sounds really fun.
We're doing that twice. And we've got, this is the, I believe the 100th anniversary of Columbia Pictures. So, Rita Belda, who is a Wisconsin native and a big shot over at the Sony Columbia, as far as restorations, has provided us with a wonderful, I think we probably have about 10 of these things from throughout the years of Columbia Pictures. We're showing everything from silent Frank Capra films that he made for Columbia in the 1920s with live piano accompaniment from our friend, the pianist David Drazen, who comes up from Chicago for the festival every year and also comes to Cinematheque a few times a year to play piano for silent films. Everything from that to John Carpenter's Christine, which was made for Columbia Pictures. Nice. We have a brand new 4K restoration of that. That's going to look gorgeous on the screen. Anytime you can see a John Carpenter movie in a movie theater, you should go and do it.
Absolutely.
I mean, he's a master of the widescreen.
All right.
So, tons of fantastic restorations. That's another thing that I think really makes the Wisconsin Film Festival special is that, yes, we show a ton of brand new movies from around the world, but we also have those movies in conversation with movies from previous decades, from throughout the whole history of cinema. So that if we're going to do a new documentary about Ennio Morricone, the famous film composer, we're also going to show some films that Ennio Morricone made the score for. So, you know, you get the context of the new films through some of these older films.
You guys have had so many great films there over the years, just letting me be part of it, which is an honor.
So we're happy to have you.
I saw Mystery Road.
Great team member.
Oh, thank you.
What'd you see?
I saw a film called Mystery Road that Jim Healy told me about 4 or 5 years ago. Loved it. Watched
that Australian movie, right?
Yeah. Watched the sequel with my son Joe about 3 years ago. That was cool. The Fabulous Stains. I saw a W.C. Fields movie there a few years ago. There's just so much for everybody there. If you had, if you could tell one, people said I could see one movie this year. What would you tell them to see?
Well, look, I don't know, this is going to be what I would say for me.
Okay.
Because your taste is your taste. I'm a big horror movie guy, but I'm very picky about horror movies. I don't know that.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah. I don't like 90% of horror movies, but the 10% that I do like, I absolutely love. When I was a kid, I saw Halloween when I was like 13, when it first came out, and I hid under the seat for the whole thing. But it changed me, and I've been chasing that feeling of being terrified in a movie theater ever since. We've got a horror movie this year that I had the privilege of seeing a couple months ago in an empty theater, and it is absolutely fantastic, absolutely terrifying, but also very funny, but just terrific. It's got a crazy title. It's called In a Violent Nature, but we're showing it on Friday night. It's the kind of movie you need to see in a movie theater, with a whole bunch of scared people all around you. It's kind of like I don't want to give too much away about it. I saw it without knowing anything about it, and I couldn't have loved the movie anymore. But it's kind of like if somebody decided to make a Friday the 13th movie, but that they actually knew how to make movies, that's what this is. I hate Friday the 13th movies, but this one is like Friday the 13th made by a master auteur of directing.
Wow.
Just an incredible immersive experience.
Friday night. Okay, I have one more
very,
question.
Very bloody.
For Ben Reiser, and I'm going to ask him to tell a Bruce Springsteen story that I might have to remind him about when we come back. This is a Nite Lite with Pete Schwab on the Civic Media Radio Network. Assuming that there are some out there, they're probably alone, solitaire. I can remember when I caught up with a pastime intimate friend. She said, but you're probably going to say I look lovely, but you probably don't think nothing of me. Welcome back. Got a couple more minutes here with Ben Reiser from the Wisconsin Film Festival. Ben, the sequel to Mystery Road, I might have liked even more, is called Goldstone. Have you seen that?
I saw them both. I think I liked Mystery Road better. I think I thought the main actor, I thought his performance was better in Mystery Road.
That may
but
be.
I could be wrong.
The scenery and the production value, or the cinematography, I should say, in Goldstone was I'm blown away by it. So anyway,
I love that guy, whoever that actor is,
Aaron Peterson. Fantastic.
Yeah, he's great.
He's great. Yeah. So, all right. So, what was the film Friday night? Something violent in the title.
In a Violent Nature.
In a Violent Nature. Okay, great. All right.
Marquee at Union South. Kids, this is what you want to see. You want to see some blood? Come this way. Awesome. There will be blood. I will tell you that much.
All right. So before I let you go, Ben, I'm sure you have tons of work still ahead of you tonight. I can't remember if it was you or your wife last year at opening night told me the story about when you went to see Springsteen. How great is it that he's back continuing his tour now? I'm hoping to maybe even catch him again. But you guys went to see a show in Baltimore, and tell us what happened again. That was so funny.
Well, we didn't have tickets. And we were driving to Baltimore, and we knew we wanted to go to the show. And so all through the drive, I think we were driving from New York to Baltimore. We were on I was driving, but my wife and my daughter were both on their cell phones on competing sort of like StubHub sites, trying to find a ticket for less than $400. Cause tickets to this last tour were insanely priced right off the bat. They were doing that. What do they call it? That dynamic pricing where it's like, if there's a high demand, it's like $1,000 for just to buy a ticket directly from Ticketmaster. So it's crazy. But anyway, the day of the show, prices were dropping and dropping. And we finally found three seats, which we thought were really good. And they were like, $200 or $300 each. So we were still like, it's going to be close to $1,000 for this thing. But I was like, okay, it's worth it. My daughter had never seen Springsteen. I couldn't imagine if I'd ever have a chance to see him with her again. And she was into the idea. So we got these tickets last minute, and we show up at this stadium, whatever it was, this arena, Baltimore Arena. I don't even remember what the name of the place is, you know, and there's 20,000 people there. And we get there and we've got these, you know, newfangled tickets on our smartphones or whatever. And we walk into the gate and we go through a metal detector. We have to empty our pockets and stuff, but nobody's asking to see our tickets and nobody has scanners that are scanning these tickets. And I'm like, well, at some point they're going to ask for the tickets, but we keep walking and walking. And now we're in, we're like, you know, practically at our seats and still nobody has asked us for the tickets. Nobody was asked us to even turn our phones on. And as we're walking, I'm starting to hear other people around us that are saying the exact same thing. I don't know what was going on that night, but they didn't check a single ticket for the whole concert.
Like the whole grid was down or something.
We spent like $900 or something. We could have just walked in for free. Unbelievable.
But they can't announce that because then they open it up to potential terrorists or whatever. I mean, you guys, they probably played it right. Just let people go in and they wouldn't be here if they didn't have a ticket, right?
Well, absolutely. And I'm sure they never did it again. I'm sure there must have been some kind of technical issue. And they're just, I mean, they must like, well, we'll have a riot in our hands if we keep everyone out until we can figure out how to scan tickets. So, you know, people aren't going to show up unless they already have tickets. But they don't know me. I mean, when I was a kid, I used to go to Madison Square Garden all the time. And older friends of mine taught me how to do this. You get an old ticket stub from some concert the year before. And you tuck a $5 or $10 bill under that. And you find the oldest guy taking tickets at the door of Madison Square Garden. And you put this thing in his hand. And he can feel the money underneath the ticket stub. And he just sends you right in. So
he just let a terrorist into the building.
Yeah, well, this was pre-terrorism, my friend.
Some idiot in Baltimore forgot to charge the scanners, and there you go. Yeah. We went to see him at Wrigley Field this summer. It was the first time I took my kids. I had been waiting to do it, and the timing just never aligned, and it was just perfect. It was like the most gorgeous night. I spent so much of my childhood at Wrigley Field, and to see him play there. But the tickets were like $490 for four tickets from the venue. What the heck? Yeah. The ticket brokers just jack it up. It's like almost not even – you can't even blame Springsteen. I mean, that was a really reasonably priced show to see an icon like Springsteen, you know?
Yeah. No, so, I would never blame Springsteen for anything. Yeah. Did you see him? He was on Curb Your Enthusiasm this week.
No, I got to see that. I know.
He's great. Very fun.
Hey, buddy, I can't thank you enough. This was so much fun. I know you got a lot on your plate, but really appreciate the time.
I can't wait to see you this weekend. You're going to be in Madison. You're going to be introducing some films. You're going to do some panels. It's going to be great.
It's going to be a blast, as always. It's a great festival.
We'll have a drink or two at the Park Hotel. We'll reminisce.
We'll talk
about the time I came on the show and made a bad Terry Gar joke.
Someone had to. You're the best, buddy. Thanks so much.
Thanks, Pete.
That is Ben Reiser. Check out the Wisconsin Film Festival. It starts tomorrow night at the Barrymore Theatre, which is sold out, but it runs through April 11th. So definitely check it out. They have so many great films and it's such a fun time. There's Madison is just fun to begin with, but the film festival makes it even better. Conrad, you ever been to a film festival?
I have not.
Oh, man.
Definitely want to go, though. Sounds very fun.
We should talk to our friends down the block here from the Green Bay Film Festival, too. They do it a little differently, but most film festivals, I would say, do it like the Wisconsin Film Festival does. But you've been to Madison, right?
I've been to Madison, yeah.
Okay. So that's fun. Then you got all these great films that are just like, all you want to do is go to movies. And the great thing about it is you're watching films with other people who love films. Like, I went to see Knox Checks Out or whatever it was last week with my wife. Knox Goes Away with Michael Keaton. And people in Marinette, kids go into the movie theater. They'll pay $8 and go in there and horse around. So after a couple, being shushed a couple times, they finally, an hour into the film, thought, hey, this is okay. Let's see what happens here. And they shut up. But most people, you know, sometimes people treat a movie theater like it's their living room. But at film festivals, you don't get that. You've great fellow film lovers. So I highly recommend it. Check it out this weekend, folks. If you're down there, say hello. I'll be down there. Tomorrow night on the show, legendary comic Tom Dreesen joins me. And who's our other guest tomorrow, Conrad? We have a maestro on the show. That'll be fun. I don't know if I've ever talked to a maestro. Have I?
Have you?
Yeah, he's from the La Crosse Symphony. And his name is Alexander Platt. He's a maestro. So that'll be a fun show, too. Thanks so much to Ben Reiser tonight. Thank you to Jeffrey Kurz, all the efforts they're making on behalf of our state and trying to get the rebates here. Great text tonight regarding, we got some fun projects, spaghetti in a tube. I'm so there.
Cheeseburger. spaghetti custard.
Spaghetti flavored custard, cheeseburger in a tube. You can't go wrong. This is Pete Schwaba on behalf of my compadre Conrad. We will be back tomorrow night with more Nite Lite here on the Civic Media Radio Network. Have a great night, everybody. Good night, Wisconsin.